Okay, hey, great. I am so glad that y'all are here. Thank you for joining me today. We are going to talk about leadership and grit and how you can inspire unstoppable mental toughness, not only in yourself, but in the people that you lead. And all of us know that you do not have to be a manager to be a leader. You can be a leader in your home, in your community, in your place of worship. People at work can look up to you and respect you. You don't have to have the title. By the way, before I go away from this screen, why don't you go ahead and screenshot this screen? You could screenshot this screen, and that way you know all of my contact information. Alrighty, so let's look at what we're going to be talking about today. We're going to start with grit versus willpower. And by the way, this is just what I promised y'all, and I'm even going to go in order. We're going to speak specifically about what is grit and where does it succeed where willpower fails. The second idea we're going to talk about is stress, why it's the golden ticket that most people never cash in. The third idea, our mind hacks. By the way, we're going to have quick fix mind hacks, and we're going to have mind hacks for mental toughness that take a little longer. You know what? We're all works in progress. So I'm sure that you'll like both of these kinds of ideas. The fourth idea, Einstein poker and the secret behind tilts and tells and emotional endurance. And finally, our fifth tip for today is going to be tapping into resilience after major disappointments. And I trust you'll find that these ideas today are going to help you not only in your professional life, but also your personal life. I don't know if you know well the story of Sir Ernest Shackleton and his crew on the Endurance. Their mission was to be the first expedition ever to traverse Antarctica on foot. And this was the exact path that they had intended to follow. Well, they'd been on the sea for many, many months, and finally they can see Antarctica, and then the ice starts to come in around their ship. And by the way, what's really cool, because they thought that they were going to be the first ever to traverse Antarctica and this was going to make history books, they literally had a professional photographer on board. And so that's why what you see here are real live pictures of this event. And here are the men obviously trying to chip away. They did everything they could. Well, nothing that they did worked. And one day the ship started to list, and Ernest Shackleton had to deliver that order that you never want to hear when you're at sea from the captain, and that is abandon ship. So it happened very slowly, and so the men were able to take important things. And see those little boats that are over to the side on the right there? They're going to come into the story again. And so what happened is they're still doing an expedition as best as they can, even though they're not on Antarctica. And so they did as much work as possible while they were there. And they actually lived on these ice floes for quite a while. And soon, of course, the weather is going to get warmer, right? Well, what's going to happen to those ice floes? They're going to start breaking up. In fact, one of the men literally rolled into the water, and if Shackleton hadn't been right at the right place at the right time, he would have drowned, obviously. So Shackleton recognizes that living on ice floes is not a sustainable business model. They're going to have to go someplace else. And so what he did is, if you'd be one slide ahead, that will help me. And so what he did was he sent them over to Elephant Island. And this is a depiction of them getting onto the island. And he told them of the treachery that lay ahead, because what he needed, obviously this is a drawing, what he needed was for the men, what's the next slide? For the men to be able to, for the men to be able to go over to a whaling station, and there they would be able to be rescued. So the question becomes, which of the men are going to volunteer? It's over 800 miles. It's very dangerous. So what are they going to do? So what he needed to do was he needed to get volunteers. And the question is anybody going to volunteer? Well, how many people do you think volunteered? And the answer is absolutely every single one. Every single one of these men were volunteered to go with him on this treacherous journey. He did take five, by the way. And so why did every single one of them volunteer? You know, when I first read about that, I was so astounded. And I wondered, what is it about these men? What is it about the leadership of Ernest Shackleton that was so inspiring that every single one of them wanted to make that treacherous journey, even though he made clear that their survival and safety and even the rescue was no guarantee? And I submit to you, the answer is grit. Shackleton himself had it, and he inspired it in other people. And I believe that there are things that you and I can learn about this so that we can inspire grit in ourselves and in the people that we lead. So let's look at our very first point, and that is, what is grit and how does it succeed when willpower fails? Now, there is a great book. I'm going to reference three. Off to the left, we see Kelly McGonigal's book, The Willpower Instinct. Now, listen, let me make something clear. The Willpower Instinct is a fabulous book. I am so glad I read it. It has changed my mind about willpower. I still think willpower is harder than grit, and I'm going to tell you why. Grit is by Angela Duckworth. I'm going to read a quotation by her in just a moment. I want you to know that you can get my books on Amazon, my ebooks on Amazon, and this is one of them. And the reason I'm showing this one to you right now, the Success book, is because I show people how to leverage their grit, how to use both of these, grit and the willpower instinct, okay? So this is what Angela Duckworth says. Pardon me, I'm backing up there for a moment. This is what Angela Duckworth says about grit. Grit entails working strenuously toward challenges, maintaining effort and interest over years despite failure, adversity, and plateaus in progress. Please hear what I said. Even plateaus in progress. I think that sometimes people don't succeed simply because they don't recognize they're on a plateau, by the way. Anyway, Duckworth continues, the gritty individual approaches achievement as a marathon. His or her advantage is stamina. So think stamina. And I love, by the way, the subtitle of her book, Grit, the Power of Passion and Perseverance. So if you just think of those two words, passion and perseverance, you got the idea of grit. Now, the idea of willpower, again, it is possible that you can cultivate willpower. It's true. Here's the resistance I have to teaching willpower over grit and why I like to do them both together. Willpower is very costly. It's costly in terms of time and attention and energy. And if it worked all that great, we wouldn't have a $62 billion a year weight loss industry, would we? So most people do not know how to use their willpower. And by the way, here's something interesting, y'all. Something amazing to me about willpower is that it depletes very fast. It's a very poor source of energy, if you can kind of imagine it like a use of energy, okay? It burns up very quickly. So what you want to do when you're doing willpower is to use it early in the day until you create a habit. And by the way, that's the key, okay? Now, what research has proven is that when you use willpower early in the day, you are actually stupider. I don't know if that's a word. How about more stupid? Okay. People have been in studies made to practice willpower, and then later on they're given tests and they don't do as well as when they did not have to practice willpower. So I thought that was something that was pretty interesting. So willpower to me is when you are forcing yourself to create something that's not there, that's contrary to self-image. And something that I talk about in my book that I just pointed out to y'all called Success is psychologists tell us that you'll never consistently act contrary to self-image. You must change your self-image first. That's what I teach in the success book I showed y'all. Now, grit, to me, when I think of grit, I think of a fire in the belly that is always there. You see, you might not realize that it's on, but you've already got something inside you. And again, I think of it like a pilot light, okay? Like a fire in the belly that's always inside. And what you want to do is you want to fan that flame with grit. That's what happens when you use grit. And like Angela Duckworth says again, it's all about passion and perseverance. And so it starts with the inside. And for years, I've been telling people, start with your core values, okay? Start with your core values, what you really believe in. If you like more of what I'm talking about, go ahead, screenshot this. There's that big old long honking link right there. That just lets you know that there are pages on Amazon that have just my ebook. So if that's of interest to you, or you can also write to me and I'll just send you the hot link. Okay, let's go back to you and your values. So if every day you are thinking about your core values and you remind yourself daily of those core values, that's going to help you fan that flame of grit. For example, here's one I find that I often have in common. When I'm delivering keynotes, when I'm delivering seminars, when I'm doing mentoring, I have yet to find a person that I've consulted with or mentored who says, integrity is not a value. Okay, so I think that's something that we can all relate to today, the value of integrity. Now, unpack that a little bit. And of course, it has to be personalized for you, but maybe this resonates with you. Does it resonate with you that integrity might be a stick-to-itiveness, a willingness to be an example for other people, a willingness to stay with something even when it's difficult? Most people would fall down and not get back up, but not you, because you want to be a good example for other people. You know that perseverance is key. Do you see how this idea of integrity and how it relates to perseverance is already inside you? I didn't tell you to think that. You already thought that. That's why it resonates, because it rings true to you. I just loved this acronym for grit. And what I love about it is that it keeps you at it even when the work is really hard, even when you want to stop. You know, when I was a professor, assistant professor at the Air Force Academy, I had a student. I was teaching public speaking, and I had a student. And see, the cadets have to wear their Class A's. That's the blue uniform with the jacket and everything. And a student comes up to me and he says, "Captain Jonas, I cannot possibly wear Class A's on Thursday, even though I'm supposed to speak, because I'm supposed to step to fly before, and I'll be in a flight suit. Blah 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 blah." Right? He's telling me excuse after excuse why he can't wear Class A's. So I finally just put up my hand and I said, "Cadet Johnson, if it's difficult, do it. If it's impossible, don't." Well, I was really impressed when Thursday he came to class in Class A's. I thought, you know what? That is grit. That is really cool. I love this idea of being unstoppable. And when you start to fan that pilot light inside of you, that is grit. This is what you become. You become unstoppable. And what I love about grit is that grit allows you to claim this empowering idea. Are you ready for the idea? Who decides if you're unstoppable? Who decides? The answer is you. You decide if you are unstoppable, and only you, and nobody else can make that decision. By the way, just so you know, I have to send a shout out to my assistant who just left the room. I do not have the questions up anymore. So if y'all are asking questions, he's going to have to come back upstairs and tell me, because I'm just on a roll now and I'm not reading for questions. All right. So let's go to our next point, staying on task, and talk about stress. Why it's the golden ticket which most people never cash in. I like this, and you've probably thought about this before, right? That stressed is just dessert spelled backwards. You know what? Like so much of life, it's all about how you perceive things. Whatever it is you're dealing with, whatever challenge, whether it's a person or a situation, an event, whatever it might be, it's all about perspective. There was a really interesting study by psychologist Aaliyah Crum, C-R-U-M is how you spell her last name. And she did the stress mindset measure. And she wanted to know from people, do you see stress as harmful or enhancing? And specifically, harmful to your health, vitality, performance, productivity, learning, and growth? Is it something negative to be avoided? Or is it enhancing to your health and vitality, your performance, your productivity, your learning and growth? Is it something positive to be embraced? Overwhelmingly, irrespective of their age or their sex or their profession, people said stress is negative and something to be avoided. Kelly McGonigal, and by the way, she's a name to remember, McGonigal, McGonigal. By the way, she's the one who also wrote The Willpower Instinct. I flashed a picture up earlier of hers, of her book. She also wrote a cool book called The Upside of Stress, The Upside of Stress. And she said, if you feel equal to the task at hand, then you see it as a challenge rather than a threat. So you have what's called a challenge response. Okay, we're going to call that CR, a challenge response. Now, what's interesting is that a challenge response is similar to fight or flight. Your heart races, your adrenaline spikes, your muscles and brain get more fuel. And by the way, when your muscles are getting more fuel, sometimes that feels tingly, okay? Here's the cool thing, y'all. With the CR, with the challenge response, you get a higher level of DHEA, which helps you recover and learn from stress. Now, flow, y'all have heard of the state of flow before. It's that highly enjoyable state where you're completely absorbed in whatever the task at hand is. Well, people who were in the state of flow, y'all, are clearly displaying the challenge response. Is all okay? Okay, they're clearly displaying challenge response. And this includes artists, musicians, and surgeons. Okay, are you all right? Okay, so here's something interesting. Top performers are not physiologically calm under pressure. I just learned this 2 days ago, y'all. Take note. Top performers are not physiologically calm under pressure. The state of flow is not a state of calm. You know what I'm thinking of it just now? I'm thinking that they are fully mentally engaged, okay? It's not like they're about to fall asleep. They have heightened alertness and awareness, and this gives them access to their mental and physical resources, which gives them increased confidence and enhanced concentration, and peak performance. Think about that. So what's the solution? Change your perception of stress. Instead of thinking that you need to calm down, you want to think, this kind of stress, I am equal to the challenge. I'm having a challenge response. I need to pick up my game. I need to have full mental engagement right now. It's all about perspective. Okay, you know what? We are just going to take a mini break to see if anybody is asking any questions. And it doesn't seem like y'all are, which is totally cool. Totally fine. All right. So the solution is to change your perspective. Okay, so I'm going to show you something fun. Do you see, obviously you see layers of bricks, right? Okay, so my question to you is, do you see anything between the first layer and the second layer? Just think about it. Okay, now if you can see something, go ahead and write your answer in the questions. Type answer here if you can see anything. All right, now I'm going to show you, because what we're going to do is we're going to blur out the bricks. Or not, because my thing is not working. But now we are. There we go. Now what do you see? Do you see a cigar? Do you see the ash at the end? What you might have thought was a turtle head or a rock or something. And now you see that it's a cigar. Okay, what we're going to do is we're going to go to the original slide. Do you see it? It's interesting how it's almost impossible not to see the cigar once you change your perspective. Excuse me. So I love this as a metaphor for changing your perspective. Would you give me some water, please? Because once you're willing to change your perspective, you really see the world in a whole new way. Another thing about stress, I've been trying a new workout recently, and it's called Pure Bar, okay? And it is challenging me in ways that I have never been challenged before. And I got to tell you something, I thought I was physically fit, but when I started doing that class, I was like the least fit person in the room, and I've been working out for years. And I discovered that when I was reaching stress, stressing my body, lifting heavier weights, pushing myself to a new limit, when I reached that level of stress, I was backing away. And so this great picture of this lady with weights, thank you, dear, reminds me that another way that stress is so beneficial, if you want to be stronger, you don't look at heavier weights and just say, gee, I wish I were stronger. You do the work. You do the work involved to experience that stress so that you can get stronger. So that let that be a metaphor for you. And what they say in bar classes, I'm sure what they say in other great physical fitness classes, which is if you don't challenge yourself, you don't change yourself. And I thought that was really cool because that's also one of my sayings. And so we go to, again, the idea of core values and the challenge of and stress and how we can cash in on it. Now, earlier I was talking to y'all about fanning the flame and the pilot light of your core values and about how that can really help you. All right. Something also that I just learned literally 3 days ago, and I thought this was so exciting, was there was actually a test done with Stanford University students. And during the winter break, they were divided into two groups. And group one was asked to write down their most important values and to log how their daily activities related to those values. Group two was told to just write down good things that happened to them. Now, what do you think happened as a result of this? Well, here's the answer. Probably exactly what you thought. Group one, the group that wrote down their most important values, and they recorded how their daily activities supported and related to those values. They were in better health, better spirits. They were more confident about their ability to handle stress and better academically prepared. And it's because this exercise helped the students see meaning in their lives so that stressful situations weren't just a hassle to avoid or to trudge through, but they became part of the process. Really interesting. You know what? That is a very practical solution that you can use for yourself to write down core values and talk about how your daily activities are supporting you. Or just think about it at the end of every day if you're not a big journal writer. So what you want to do for yourself and others as a leader in whatever leadership role that you play in all aspects of your life is you want to connect the dots. You want to connect with people what values they personally have. And by the way, you probably share a lot in common with the people that you lead, and how the work, how the difficult work matters and is related to those values. Let's move on to number three. Our third point for the day is mental hacks that foster mental toughness, mind hacks that foster mental toughness, okay? Our first one you've probably heard about before. This is the fabulous Dr. Amy Cuddy, and it's from her wonderful TED Talk about power poses. It is amazing. If you've never had a chance to look at it, go back and watch that fabulous video. Dr. Amy Cuddy, C-U-D-D-Y is how she spells her last name. What she's doing right there is a power pose. I always think of it as the starfish pose. Her feet are about hip distance apart. You can see for yourself, her arms are nice and wide. If you hold that power pose for 2 minutes, guess what happens? Your cortisol goes down 25%. Obviously, the stress hormone goes down 25%. Testosterone, which is associated with power and confidence, raises 20%. And here's a special bonus. Not only do you feel better, but the study that Dr. Cuddy and her colleagues did included, how do other people perceive somebody who's gone through the power pose? Obviously, you don't do this in front of people, just to double check that you know that, right? But anyway, do other people perceive people differently when they have gone through the power pose? The answer is yes. They are perceived as more competent and confident. So how cool is that? Here's another quick fix. All right. The guy on the left there who has the pencil in his teeth is forcing a smile. And if you do that for 2 minutes, okay, and see on the right there, if you hold it between your lips, you are forcing a frown. Well, what happens is the brain obviously has to activate in order to make these muscles work, right? Well, what research shows us is that if you do the one on the left there where you force a smile, you actually feel better. Isn't that weird? Even though you don't have that creepy smile, you know, that's exaggeratedly huge, but still people feel better. Conversely, if they do the one on the right, they actually feel worse. I thought that was fascinating. All right, another quick hack is the mood meter. Just screenshot this. You could also get it at images.google. And let me make sure I remember to tell you that the mood meter is a 99-cent app. It is really cool. All right. So what you want to do is you want to rate yourself on the feeling axis and also the energy axis. And you decide, where are you now? And then I'll add a bonus question. I'm going to ask you, where are you now? And the second bonus question is, where do you need to be for the task at hand? And the task at hand, at least for the next 15 minutes or 20 minutes, however long we're together today, is listening into this webinar, fully engaging in the webinar. Where do you need to be to take the notes, to listen in, to think about the practical application in your own life? Where do you need to be? And do you need to adjust a little bit? You know, I've delivered seminars and keynotes where people are actually higher. They're way off to high five, on both sides, energy and feeling. And when we talk it out, sometimes if you're not the one that gets to speak, if you're the one that needs to be on the listening side, sometimes you need to rein it in. For example, you might be really feeling good, right? Well, if you have to have a crucial conversation with somebody that you lead, if you're all happy and everything, that ain't going to go over well. So you need to modulate and have that level of self-awareness to say, where am I now? By the way, if you buy the app, what it lets you do is it lets you put your finger over all those different grid marks and it gives you words to articulate your emotions, which I think is really cool because we are definitely lacking. A lot of people are lacking in emotional literacy. We don't have words to use to express how we feel about things. And so then the question becomes, what is your plan? Okay. So if you are not where you need to be on that grid and you want a mindset for mental toughness, you want a mind hack, simply go to the mood meter and again, print it off of images.google. Okay. Print it off and say, where am I now? Where do I need to be for the task at hand? And of course, the task at hand changes throughout the course of the day. Okay. So then you ask yourself, what is my plan for getting there? Boom. Mind hack. Free will is another mind hack. I don't ever want to hear you say again that somebody makes you anything. Okay. Because if one of your core values is integrity, then integrity probably tells you that you are in charge of you and other people are not responsible for you. You're in charge of you, right? You have free will. Well, the thing to remind yourself of, the quick mind hack for mental toughness is free will all the time. There are no time outs for free will. Here is a great question to ask yourself. At what point do difficult people stop being difficult? Well, if you believe in free will, you know the answer. And the answer is the minute you decide they are not. I was reading this great book called The Obstacle is the Way, The Obstacle is the Way by Ryan Holiday. And he talks about PTSD, which you may know stands for post-traumatic stress disorder, versus PTG, which he calls post-traumatic growth. And it is the willingness to grow through a stressful situation. Adversarial growth. I thought these were cute pictures to depict adversarial growth. The idea that when we are challenged by things, we literally get stronger when we use heavier and heavier weights. That's the way it works. So you let that be your metaphor. When you allow yourself to be challenged by greater and harder situations, harder and harder tasks, you literally become stronger emotionally. A final mind hack that I would like to give you is I think of my wonderful husband, Dan, when I think of this. One of his many great qualities is that he gives everybody the benefit of the doubt. And I just love that. I think what a fabulous sense of peace people who give people the benefit of the doubt must have. I mean, just think of all of the energy you're freeing up when you just assume your default is just to assume the best about people. I'm not saying you're always going to be right, but it sure is a peaceful way to live. Let's go to our fourth concept. Our fourth concept is Einstein poker and the secret behind tilts and tells and emotional endurance. Did you know that Einstein was a great poker player? He was. He was also a theoretical physicist. You know what's interesting? If you go onto images.google, you'll actually see this really cool picture. They've got Einstein and Stephen Hawking and Sir Isaac Newton, and they're all playing poker. And the idea is that Einstein was a great poker player. I assume that the other two guys would be great gamesmen too. And one of the reasons is because they're in it for the long haul in their profession, they don't get agitated. They don't get upset. They don't get all excited. They just go with the flow. Now, if you are a poker player, you might be familiar with these terms, but if you're not, you might be interested in what they mean. Tilts are when your game is going bad, okay, and you know it's going bad, and then you start to play worse. This is within your control, okay? That's when you give the tell. The tell are outward symbols that people read. Now, you can't control what other people perceive, but if you're there going supernova, if you're disintegrating emotionally, then people are going to be able to tell that things are not going well, okay? Tilts is when you feel it inside, and tells is when other people can tell, other people can see that you're not doing well. And so what you want to do is you want to make sure that you're being self-aware, okay? You want to be self-aware. You want to know that things take time. You want to recognize, as the great golfer Jack Nicklaus recognized, that not every game is going to go well. He had a fabulous phrase called play poorly well. Play poorly well. I was talking with a gal who had a problem with, binge eating, right? And the idea is, okay, maybe you didn't mean to have the cupcake, but you don't eat a dozen. It's like if you're putting dishes away and you accidentally break a glass, it's like, oh, shoot, right? You clean it up, you throw it away, and then you keep putting the rest of the dishes away. You don't take glasses out of the cupboard and start smashing them, right? That would be like eating the second through the 12th cupcake, all right? So you recognize, okay, that did not go as well as I would hope. Let me stick with it. Let me get control of myself, and let me soldier on. I just love this guy, Colonel Chris Hadfield, who is a Canadian, and he was a fighter pilot. And then he became the commander of the International Space Station. You need to look him up online. And if you like David Bowie, he actually performed Space Odyssey in the ISS. Now, if that ain't the coolest music video I have ever seen, I don't know what is, but it is. And he can sing too, by the way, which is pretty cool. And so anyway, we learn a lot of great lessons from an astronaut's guide to life on Earth. And very specifically, what Hadfield tells us is anticipate problems so you can prevent as many as possible. He's not pretending you can prevent all of them. And he says that competence is the most important quality in order to succeed in anything. You need to keep your head in the times of crisis. You need to stick with your task. I read something by a coach from the University of Alabama for their football team, the head coach, and his key word is finish. Finish this drill. Finish this push-up. Finish this thing right in front of your face. Finish it. Don't get fixated on the end goal. Finish what is the task at hand. So back to Hadfield again. He says, keep your head, as I was saying. Improvise good solutions to tough problems. And he was asked if things went as planned in space. And his interesting response was, actually, nothing went as planned, but everything was manageable because we did plan. Let's go to our fifth and final idea for the day, and that is tapping into resilience after major disappointments. I think that optimism is something that has been greatly been misconstrued and misused. I just love this little image of this huge elephant. He's optimistic, isn't he? And I just love it that the monkey is all in, man. He is going for it. Now, you know what's going to happen. These dudes, no matter how optimistic they are not going to be successful. This is not going to be a good handoff, right? I really cringe. I love it when people are reading self-help books and listening to CDs and videos and watching videos. I just think that's fabulous, but I think that people are in for major disappointment. If anybody believes that all it takes to be successful is to just sit here, the secret is to think happy thoughts and somehow you're going to attract things to you. And that's just not true. Okay. Faith without works is dead. We just can't sit there and think happy thoughts. It is not optimism. It's another way of looking at it. It is called realistic optimism. Tattoo that one on your heart, okay? Realistic optimism. You must be open and honest with yourself and other people about challenges even before you begin. Let them know, hey, this is new. We're pioneers. Never call somebody a guinea pig. They are always a pioneer. Guinea pigs are not in it voluntarily, okay? We hope that your people are there because they want to be there, all right? And so you need to let people know that no idea goes from inception to execution without finding out what doesn't work. That's one of my signature phrases. Let me repeat it. No idea goes from inception to execution without finding out what doesn't work. Let people know ahead of time. We're going to find out what doesn't work. As soon as you find out what doesn't work, let me know what you think will fix it. Did you hear what I said? The expectation is that they will come to you with some ideas, all right? Not just complaining. So we want to have the growth mindset. Carol Dweck, D-W-E-C-K. Carol Dweck is known for her work and her book, by the way, on growth mindset. And so what growth mindset does is it approaches growth versus fixed. And it was my man, Dan, that enlightened me to these two ideas a while back. Fixed mindset says, well, I'm either good or I'm not good. You know, I'm not going to get better. So I really don't want to risk it. Because if you already see me as smart, I don't want to look stupid in your eyes. So I'm just not going to risk it. But growth mindset is this wonderful spirit of, hey, I could learn it. Yeah, I'll probably fall down 7 times, get up 8. I win. Let's move. Right. I have a theory, what I call the theory of 12. A while back, I started periscoping. And by the way, at the end of this, I'm going to give you all of my contact information. So make sure you screenshot the last slide, okay? In case we'd like to follow each other, I'd love to follow you too. So please let me know how I can do that. And so I started periscoping and I thought, you know what? I'm just not going to do very well at first, but that's okay because it probably takes about, 12 periscopes before I'm comfortable, right? And then I said to myself, well, if I only do one periscope a month, it's going to take me a year to get good at this. But if I do 4 a day, I will nail this in 3 days. So guess what I did? I did 4 a day for 3 days. I sure did. I just knocked those hummers out, man. I just went for it. And you know what? If you also have a theory of 12, and it doesn't have to be 12, it's whatever, right? But this idea that you're going to need to do something a lot before you start to get good. Listen to what teacher woman's saying. I'm not saying that on the 13th one, I was great and then I quit learning. I trust that I'm getting better because I'm deliberately practicing. Do you see what's going on there? You deliberately practice. You keep that growth mindset. The key is to fail forward fast, okay? So play poorly well is the same general kind of idea. We're going to close with this, and then we're going to go back to Shackleton, but this is my last great tip. The wise person does nothing reluctantly. I heard that about a month ago for the first time from the Stoic philosopher who was around the time of Jesus, Seneca, said the wise person does nothing reluctantly. And you know what? Since I have read that, I've really internalized that. And I am very careful about catching myself when I say, I have to do this. I have to do that. It's like, really? I don't have to do it. I do it because I want to do it. I do it because it's in keeping with my personal value system. So just run that by yourself and see if it resonates. Let's go rescue Shackleton's crew, shall we? So there we were, Shackleton and his crew had to abandon the Endurance. He left them on Elephant Island for a very treacherous traverse across 800 nautical miles to a whaling station. After 3 months, he was successful, and he brought every single man back alive. What a great story. What a great story of grit, of passion, and perseverance. Okay, my friends, this is the screen to screenshot. I do webinars, I do seminars, I do mentoring and coaching. If there's anything that I could do for you, please let me know. I'm going to attempt to send you this recording that will appear in an email to you tomorrow. It may work, it might not work. I hope that it does, y'all. I hope that you enjoyed this. If you did, be sure to say something nice on social media about it. Send people back to my website. Sure would appreciate it. Thanks a lot, y'all. Take care. Over and out.